Captain Hook.
No, Ricky Champ's responsible for Captain Hook.
Excellent.
It was inevitable.
Yes.
It was an inevitable thing that I'd play Captain Hook one day. I've been pirates before. I done a film, Peter and Wendy, a few years ago.
Right.
And Stanley Tucci was Captain Hook.
He was, yes.
And I was one of his pirates.
Oh, really?
And it was wonderful. And it was great to be in close proximity to a wonderful hook.
Wonderful. Absolutely.
I've been around some really amazing hooks, you know. I've seen I've always loved Peter Pan. And then as I got older, I realised I didn't love Peter Pan that much. I love Captain Hook. From the Disney to Dustin Hoffman, amazing. In the film Hook, fantastic depiction.
Yeah.
Actually, probably the best for me. Jason Isaacs was a wonderful hook.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, we've had a really bad communication error. Ah.
Now, what's the deal with you both working together? Is this the first time, or is this...
It's the first time we've met each other today.
Okay.
And we're already best of friends.
Yeah.
No. That's the idea. Peter's best friends with everyone, though, isn't he?
He is, yeah. He's a player with the bat in that sense.
He's a proper goodie.
Already.
He's a proper goodie.
Friends to all.
Yeah. Smee's whoever he's speaking
Smee's
to.
Smee's half a goodie, half a bad.
It depends who he's speaking
Smee
to.
Smee doesn't know where he sits, really, does he?
It's a bit more odd. Right. Cap's really well.
He's either got a conscience or he's very confused. I think.
Again, great.
And Sheffield, and then I played a different fairy, Dick Whittington, in Crawley, and now I'm here. So, I may have missed one. I really enjoy playing it because she's really sassy, she's very feisty, but you also see her soft side as well as the cheeky side. So I feel like as an actor, it's very fun to play. And also as a kids' TV presenter, it's also quite fun for me to play a role that's very different to the one that I'm known as on TV.
Yes.
So it's quite fun.
Off that, and that is actually one of the biggest reasons why I'm doing it, actually.
Yeah.
You know, I've been, it's all been very close, television, in my face for the last 4.5 years.
Yeah.
And this is going to be a bit of a release, I think. I love the stage, I've always been on stage. It's very different techniques, very different, very, very different in how to get the story across. Television comes into you, theatre has to go out to everyone. So it's quite a harsh transition, actually. It's not the same art at all, but one that I love. Yeah. That's not a new thing, you know. I've done lots of classical theatre in my early career, and Shakespeare's a science to the audience, you know. They're there, and pantomime has just acquired that, and in a very comedy way, obviously, but it's wonderful. It's a wonderful thing to be able to do that, to speak to them. Tells the story much better, brings them in much better, people get sucked in. Yeah, I love it.
Absolutely.
Originally, I'm from Wolverhampton.
Right, yeah, so I could hear the Birmingham in you.
Yeah, the Wolverhampton.
The Wolverhampton.
Oh.
It's always...
We're going to have to a terrible start.
Yeah. Fourth with Gemma, I think, third or fourth. This is my seventh Peter Pan, I think. And
seventh
I think I've
Peter
done about,
Pan?
Yeah, I think I've done about 10 or 11 Pantos.
Wow. Yeah. And what about you, Mark?
Well, it's my seventh overall, because I've only ever worked with UK productions. So I've done like Jack and the Beanstalk, Aladdin, Cinderella last year in Aylesbury, and Captain Hook this year. So mixing it up a little bit. This is the first time that I've not played, David's role, being Aladdin or Jack, or I was Dandini last year. So this is really great for me because like,
you get
the
a bit of a free
hits.
Range to muck
yeah.
about.
Yeah, it's
bit,
lovely, yeah. yeah. Which like you know what I've been doing for the whole of my career, so like, I'm pretty happy with that. Really.
If we get bored, we can just swap as well.
Exactly.
We'll do a matinee this way and then an evening the other way.
Exactly. Keep guessing.
See how it goes. See how it goes. Now your character has to.
Yeah. In the traditional Panto, this is obviously the sequel to the original, and in this one, he's a little bit less willing to drive the story, I think is the best way to say it, without giving too much away. He doesn't.
So you know all about it already?
I do. I know the secrets. there's a rumour going around that Captain Hook is back after 100 years.
I've just seen him over there. He's doing an interview over there.
Is it?
Yeah. Yeah. Or just Mick Jagger, one of the two.
But yeah, it's a really fun new take on Peter Pan, set a long time after the original.
Yeah, Panto is really special. It gives lots of people the opportunity to come to the theatre, often for the first time, because you can come as a family. But it doesn't really set you up for how to behave later when you go to watch another show, because this is the one where we want people to get involved. We want there to be audience participation. We want them shouting out and booing and hissing and singing along with us. Whereas when you then go and watch a play or a musical on the West End, they don't necessarily want you to do that. But that's what I like about Panto, is that people can get involved and they feel like they're the extra part of the cast as well. So I work on CBeebies, which is primarily for preschool and primary age. The program that I work on, which is Swashbuckling, which is a private game show,
yes.
It's one of those programs that I think that children that perhaps have grown up from CBeebies will still watch, because it's a bit like us watching Funhouse or Crystal Maze when we were kids. It's a really fun show that children can watch. They can really engage with the children that are on the TV. They really get involved with the comedy and the drama and the fun of the game. And so I think it's one of those shows that it doesn't matter what age you are, if you can get over perhaps what channel it's on, you will enjoy watching it.
Elements of psychopath to a few characters that I've played. Him and her especially, but all he was just so confused and so angry and so not very bright. And a joy to play.
Yeah.
That. A joy to play that. Stuart Highway in EastEnders was different, was much more complex, much more. I mean, the longer you play someone, the more history you can make. You don't have to invent it, you know?
Yeah.
Which is what you have to do on any acting job.
Yeah.
Invent your history. But in EastEnders, after a few years, you've got it. You've lived it.
Yeah.
And you end up knowing your character more than the writers. More than, you know, it's like, well, actually, no, we can't do this because of that 2 years ago. Or, you know, and yeah, and because of that, it becomes really an ensemble bit of work, you know, with the actors, the writers, the camera people, the directors, so many directors, the turnover, every week and a half, another director comes in to start their block, and you're finishing off the last block. So at any one time, you've got 8 episodes in your bag, if you're in them all. And I think my world record was, I think it was 26 episodes in my bag that needed to be shot, and they needed finishing.
Wow.
And I was shooting them all out of order, so I had to have that whole arc in my head. Some people have had more than that. You can't shoot it chronologically. It's location takes precedent, yeah? So, you know, one director will come in and he will have the exterior for his 4 episodes for a few days, and he will try and shoot out everything that happens outside. So in that first week of him, you could be going into the vid, yeah? And then the next week, you'll pick up going into it when you should be into it.
Oh, how interesting.
Yeah, with a vid.
Crikey, So continuity must be unbelievable.
Well, that's why you have to stay on top of your continuity.
Yeah.
You know, there were continuity mistakes in the biggest budget films in the world.
Oh yeah,
do you know what I mean?
Nowadays, you
on something like all. That, it's inevitable that it's going to happen. But you have to stay on top of it, and they do. It's quite extraordinary, actually.
Yeah.
It's a beast of a television show.
I've heard. That's what Paul Nicholas said it was.
Beast.
He said it was a beast.
EastEnders has been the flagship show for the BBC for the last, you know, 3.5-4 decades.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
It's really great to be part of it. To have been part of it.
So back to...
What you want a Panto to be, family friendly obviously, you know, great physical guarantees for the kids, or with the adults, you know, there's enough in there where you think, oh, got away with that. That's
excellent.
Great. Which is what you want.
And you've got a real bagging Captain Hook over there, haven't you?
I think all the nice people play really good bad guys because they're just like, you know, I'm just going to let it go.
Get out of the
system. Let that lovely persona, you know, go. But yeah, he seems like a lovely bloke.
Stephen Fadden was my Captain Hook here in 2014.
Oh really? Yeah. Well, that's why. So I've met you before.
You met me before. Yeah, I was a bit blonder then and a bit younger. That was my first ever Peter Pan.
Oh wow! And you've done seven since then.
Yeah.
It's pretty impressive, isn't it? It's pretty impressive. You've affected so much. Like we were the first to close, we were the last to open. That was just the way it was. But it was just nice for the theatre doors to open and you'd be able to do your job. Like last year, we were on tenterhooks because, you know, with all the lateral flow testing and sort of, and it was pretty rife in the country still, and we didn't know whether we were going to be able to finish off the run.
It was day by day, wasn't it?
It was
waiting to see whether the show was happening that night or not.
That's it.
Yeah. What I will say though, I don't know if it was, if you noticed it as well, the audiences last year were louder, crazier, more involved than I think I've seen them in years, which was lovely actually, because for us, like, you know, we craved that, you know, that interaction, and it was so lovely.
They're like caged animals, weren't they? They just like come out and, you know, have a social gathering with people. Mm-hmm. It's just really nice to see.
And we usually stay as close to the script as we can, but occasionally things go awry.
You never remember it. You know, I think for me that is a great thing because if I am struggling with the script, I'll just go off on one. And as long as I've got where I need to be at the end.
By the end.
That's the scope for the comedy character, thank you very much.
That's it.
We'll be loving that. Thank you.
Yeah, I'm really excited to play in it. And as we were just talking about in Panto, you can be bigger, you can be a much more animated version. And I'm really looking forward to doing that. It will be Ricky Champ's Captain Hook. It's like the old thing of my Hamlet, your Hamlet.
Yeah.
We'll both do the Hamlet, right? But that would be so different because of who we are. And I'm not the first person to play Captain Hook, and I won't be the last. but it will be my version. There are some things that are inescapable, though. He has to be kind of educated. Or seemingly educated in a way that gives him precedent and authority over the other pirates.
Yes.
And which isn't exactly hard because they're all depicted as quite dim. He's very suave. I think he's going to be a lot, maybe a little bit better spoken than I am.
Yeah.
A little bit more heightened. He's like, he wants to be in the core of Charles II, doesn't he?
Yeah.
But he is evil as well.
Yes.
And we can't lose that. He's quintessentially the villain, Captain Hook.
Yes.
Now, Neverland as well has this magic. It has this magic of game, that everything is the game. You know, and Pan says it a few times. He's just playing his game the whole way through, and Captain Hook is part of his game until it goes too far. It's like kids who play fight, and then it turns real. And I was thinking about this the other day of this magic that Neverland has, where you can always be a child, and in a way that does extend even to the pirates.
Yes.
I love it. Because that's the whole thing, isn't it? Like, a lot of times as well in stories of Peter Pan, you're not really sure if it's a dream. You know,
I know,
you're not 100% sure that you flew out the window to the second star on the right with the fairy. You know, did that happen? No. we had just woken back up in our beds.
I know.
And I love that dreamlike quality of it. And because of that, and that's really apparent, that dreamlike quality. And because of that, it's another reason, as well as it being a pantomime, that we can be huge.
And
indeed, Hook can be nightmarish. I think you get a week rehearsal, and then you start tech.
It's unbelievable.
So you're rehearsing for a week, then you're on the stage for the start of your tech. You have to use that tech as a rehearsal as well.
Yeah.
Because you keep going back and forth. You tech a couple of minutes, then you go back 1 minute. Then you tech a few minutes, then you go back 1 minute. And that's what a tech is. Just all of the technical aspects, the sound, the lights, the flying, the Tinkerbell's magic, everything. Everything has to be plotted in a machine and then stored. And it's a painstaking process. And actually it can leave the actors on stage at some, like quite often, sweating in wigs.
Yeah, I bet.
Thinking, I don't know if I can sing that again or, you know. Yeah, but so you have to stay focused. And actually, you're so in it and you're so consumed by it by the end of the tech that the next day after the tech is done you're off.
Yeah,
so unbelievable.